issues.
And on today's episode, we'll be talking about corruption. I am your host, Siprent Joy. I'm here with Mr. Henry and my co-host, Basi Ekene. And welcome to our show, guys.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you.
We all know the fight against corruption in Nigeria is no longer in news, Mr. Henry. Do you think Nigeria has got to the point where it can never be faced anymore?
Corruption is a dictionary word, and there is no country without the element of corruption. But how to manage it and tackle it is, in all honesty, it's a different case on its own. The situation we find ourselves in Nigeria is that we have come to make corruption part of governance, which is not good. So we need to find a way to get rid of corruption in all honesty. And it has not gotten to a bad where we cannot be fixed anymore.
So what do you think are the things that we need to do in Nigeria to actually get rid of this corruption? And can corruption ever be gotten rid of in Nigeria?
Yes, we need to have the right people in governance and also make governance unattractive for the criminals who has hijacked the governance so far, and also make governance their daily mail ticket. So if we are able to get the right people with the right pedigree in governance, we should be able to ameliorate the situation we find ourselves, which is corruption. That's killing our economy.
So we should have faith that one day corruption will be over in Nigeria.
It's not about having faith, but we need to step in and also find a way to get into the government and also try and see what we can do to reduce corruption in our country.
Okay, fine. Talking about the youth, do you think the youth can actually ever have a place in governance in this country? Because the way it goes, it seems like everything revolves around the old man that actually started the governance since the independence, and up to now, they're still the ones ruling, they're still the ones in government. More like there's no space for the youth.
The truth of the matter is that, a former American writer will always say, power is given and not the power is taken and not given. So we can't continue. The youth cannot continue to wait for the power to be given to them. We need to use that time. Everybody has to be on board. Everybody must have to be on board, and then must sit and see how we can retire these old people who has drowned out the nation and looted all our hard-earned money. And see what we can do. But for now, we still find ourselves in a situation where somebody who has ruled before since 1970s is continuing to rule.
Okay. So, Mr. Henry, you're actually a youth. What are those things you think you feel you should put in place to actually come together to rule the covenants? I mean, you also, I think, you should have an ambition to rule the covenants one day. So, what are the things you actually think?
The truth of the matter is, if I say we should be on the streets, some people will misunderstand what we mean by being on the street. And however, what we need to constantly do is what we're doing now. We should be the voice to the masses who are not enlightened to understand exactly what is going on up there. So constant talking about it, constant preaching, and so that the message will be the same. The youth has to be stepping. You have to step in and then get involved in the governance.
Let's talk about the investigation of NDDC and EFCC. Do you think it's a real test of transparency for the present administration?
It ought to be, but unfortunately, it will all be swept under the carpet as usual.
Okay.
Because the present government has a way of when they want to have a way of using the agency, security agencies, to fight opposition. But when it comes to dealing with the main issue, which is dealing with corruption, they turn to sweep it under the carpet. And it's a problem. The NDDC is an eye-opener for everyone in the country with the level of corruption that's happening in every agency.
Yeah.
It's not only NDDC.
Okay.
But there are other agencies where politicians used to launder and loot our votes.
Yeah, looking at the NDDC, I feel personally the NDDC have failed to an extent. Because NDDC was actually founded to take care of the Niger Delta areas. But if you look at the roads, the ecological system, the environment, it is nothing to write home about. Like looking at Imo State, or even the Cross River State, the Bayelsa, the ecosystem is nothing to write home about. Like, and you tend to think, what are they doing with this money? What are they doing? Niger Delta is actually the triple of the nation oil well. And then you look at the states there, they are actually nothing. The people, the system of the people living, the living system is so poor. The ecological system is so poor.
Can we blame everything on the government?
Basically,
don't you think individuals, we as a person, have one thing or the other to contribute to
ourselves?
No,
basically, we've moved from the original to why the NDDC was created in the first place.
Okay.
Because let's not make a mistake about it. NDDC was not created to take the problem, care of the whole problem of the NDDC region. But the politicians have turned it to their meal tickets.
Yeah.
So for each construction project that they all apply for, once the funds are released, they put it into their bank account.
At this stage, what should be done?
Well, we need to get the right people to manage the affairs of the NDDC.
Yeah.
And we also need to take the NDDC to grassroots and not let it not be the political affairs. So I personally have a problem with people sitting down to elect who becomes the NDDC directors, or down to the contractors and every other thing. So I feel it should be thrown open to the indigents of the NDDC to elect whom they choose, whom they want to take charge of the affairs of the NDDC.
Yeah, talking about transparency and accountability, do you think there should be a system put in check for the government to cross-check all these things?
So growing up, we were taught in government about checks and balances in government. Unfortunately, what we see today is no longer obtainable, and it all bounces back to goes down to the wire. Having the right people in governance, and we cannot continue to elect criminals in government and hoping to get best results from them. So if you elect somebody with a good pedigree, with a good understanding of what lawmaking legislation is, or has good understanding of what checks and balances is, it's a platform, it's an arrangement that calls questions to executive, and the executive response and to the legislation. Well, unfortunately, we've lost that concept. So all we do today is the executive elects who becomes the hierarchy in the legislation and approves whatever thing they bring up to them. So it's our problem to.
I feel even if it is taken to the grassroots, it will just be who comes in, fake is our family or people or state.
Because
there's always been like that. Because if you look at the youth in Rivers, presently with this saga happening, the NDDC, the youth in Rivers, they actually gang up, marched to the NDDC headquarters, protesting that the government in power should come back before the so it's actually
crazy
and very funny.
Are they speaking for the entire youths?
That's
of
supposed.
No, but they are not, because
they
are not. That's a microscopic few who may probably were paid by politicians and sponsored to go out to do that. But I am speaking as a youth who understands what every youth in Niger Delta is going through. And I am telling you now that nobody who we see what is going on, that you mentioned, both in Imo State, Niger State, Rivers Delta, will come out and say, I am against accountability and probe on NDDC. No,
I
that is not.
I know you have a lot to say. We're going on a short break. We'll be right back.
This is Afro Issues.
Welcome back. Some people say we need to have more youth in government or public offices. Do you think this is a key to true fight against corruption?
In a civil environment, that is a good idea. But we live in a country where the cost of governance is very expensive. And I don't think any youth would want to match with the type of money, ill-gotten money, these politicians have and they throw around during the type of elections.
Mr. Henry, you said the cost of governance is actually expensive. What do you mean by that? Can you explain better?
The cost of governance is very expensive when I said that is in two ways.
Okay.
We all know that the only industry today going on in Nigeria is politics. So the politicians have turned governance into money-making venture, whereby you go into politics, you become a millionaire. You start building houses, building hotels,
buying cars, and expensive things.
So everybody wants to be a politician. So people tend to borrow money, go as far as borrowing money from banks to run election. I know of a man who spent about $4 billion to conduct an election. So to run a successful campaign in Nigeria, be it local government or from local government to presidency, you have to spend up to billions. The youths don't have it.
For the campaign.
In that case,
I feel Nigeria should be more educated, more on these election processes and everything, because it's more like if you don't bribe someone, they won't vote for you. So then the youth will actually be afraid because they don't have such money, I feel so, yeah.
So that brings us back to what I said earlier, that we need people with character and pedigree to come into running affairs of the nation.
How do we know people with character?
We all know people with sound background, sound educational background and business background. It's hard time to call them to get involved and also come and impact our economy with their wealth of experience.
I feel those people will also come in and still try to exploit the government because they are also looking for their own.
No, everybody likes power. Power is almost everything. I know people who yearn to be in governance, not for money they want to get. They're already successful in life. All they need is power. And that is why most Western world countries tend to get it right, because they want people, they have people who are willing to serve and not about what they want to take.
Yeah. So the way you're saying, it's not like you have political ambition. Good luck to you on that. They don't come and be one of them. Because it will really be good to have the youth come into the politics and change the old face of what is happening in Nigeria.
I think the time is almost happening, because I know there was a plan of a revolution that happened in that, but the government tried everything they could to thwart that particular movement.
Yeah.
But I think someday it's going to happen and the youth will take over.
So, Honorable Sir, what do you have to say to the young ones, youth, aspiring to be in government or probably in power?
At this point, is to stay away from bad politicking and also go back to the whole thing to the land of our government.
Bad politicking, I don't understand what you mean by that. Is it bad stay politics away from godfathers or what?
That is one. And also stay away from trying to bribe the INEC, and also the usual thing we used to know about politicians in Nigeria, which is going deal making in the night and also trying to steal the ballot box and they were talking.
Because I feel if the youth really come in and then they don't just stay at the background, try to work for these mangoes, try to work for people like, you know, the country would be better.
Well, that is what politicians try to do. They try to suppress the youth and also make them to do what they want.
Exactly.
And not having them to live their dreams. Yeah. So in the past, we had people, our current president was a president during the military child at the age of 30-something. So why can't we achieve that? These are the questions we need to
And these are the same people that say you have to be so age before you get into the government.
So.
But then they started ruling at a very young age. So I feel the youth should come up. They should come into the governance. Take up and then...
The question is, the youth are not writing the right question and they are not bold enough to challenge these people. And that is why, personally, I have ambition to run. And so many people have called me to ask me questions like, do you think you can match these people? Do you have money to bribe INEC? Do you have money to pay security agencies and this? And I'm like, no. But I have the message. It is time for the youth to take over.
Yeah,
and retire this old hag. And retire this old hag. And my message to tomorrow is the youth has to support their own and protect their own.
Yes.
So the ability to make the message get to the grassroots determines what the youth, what happens to the youth tomorrow.
Exactly, because the youth actually want money before they vote. They don't care about who you are. They don't care about what you have to offer. The only thing they really actually want is
it's all part
and
of,
you give them, you take them.
It's all part of what the police have made the system to talk to be into, make life difficult for people. And when they give you small out of what they've stolen from you, can do whatever they want to do. So it's about controlling the youth. And
thank you so much for coming on today's, and I hope we will invite you next time. Thank you so much. Please, guys, subscribe to our YouTube channel and every other platform showing on your screen right now. And youth, the time is now. Fight for your right. Don't sell your future for peanuts. Please, we need to stand up and fight. Thank you. See you same time next week. I remain your host, Supreme Joy. Bye.